salida del poli. This is the Rolls Royce engine. Rolls Royce Merlin. Air cooler motor Franklin 0-A05-2.
So, if we go back to 1944, we find these planes all over Europe and especially in places like Asia. Okay, these are spotter planes. They're not meant to go ahead, they don't have any weapons on them. They're not meant to have any weapons on them. They're just meant to go ahead and spot for artillery or spot the enemy and stuff like that. But in 1944, you get one guy by the name of Charles Carpenter. And Charles Carpenter was, before the war, a history teacher. He taught high school history, okay? But in 1941, when the United States went to war, he volunteered, and they taught him how to fly airplanes. But they didn't teach him how to fly the F-6F Hellcat like you see back there. It was a fighter. They didn't teach him how to fly B-17 like you see these women of the Air Force Service pilots or the WASPs. They taught him how to fly this. This is the L-4 Grasshopper. And he didn't have a problem with that, but he wanted to do more to help the guys on the ground. So what he did was he got his hands on 6 bazookas. Now, does anybody know what a bazooka is? What?
A rocket launcher swarm.
Yeah. It's one of the first rocket-propelled grenade launchers to take out tanks. Anybody know where it got its name? Nope. Believe it or not, this is a bazooka. This was an instrument invented by a comedian in the 1930s by the name of Bob Burns. Now, legend has it that Bob Burns was the only one who could play the bazooka. See, what he did was he invented this instrument, and they said, man, what are you doing? And they say, well, I'm playing my bazooka. So, this is what a bazooka sounds like. And even though they didn't destroy the Pacific Fleet, they went ahead and they did cripple it. They blew up the Arizona, which sank and is still in the harbor today. They went ahead and they basically disabled a bunch of the ships, the USS Nevada and stuff like that. And their true targets, the aircraft carriers of the American Pacific Fleet, were not there. They were at sea on maneuvers when it happened. So the United States caught a break on that one. But because of the morale of the people at that time, and because of the things that were going on, the United States and the President of the United States thought we needed a morale boost. The people needed to know that we were gonna go ahead and not out of the fight yet. So they had to come up with a plan. Now, at this time, the Air Force hadn't been created, okay? It was the Army Air Corps. So the Air Force was actually part of the United States Army. That's why you see this B-25 Mitchell in the colors of the Army, but the star and the blue field, the star and the red dot, that's the colors of the Air Force. But back then it was all the Army Air Corps, all right? Or the airplanes were in the Navy, Naval Aviation, okay? Now here's the bad part. At the beginning of the war, we didn't have a bomber that could go from the continental United States all the way to Japan, bomb and come back. They just couldn't do it. We didn't have any Navy carriers that could do the same thing because they could only bomb small targets. They were made to bomb other ships, not necessarily anything big. So they had to do something. So a submarine commander came up with a mission. They came up with how they were gonna do it. What they were gonna do is put Army planes on Navy aircraft carriers. Now these planes are not made to take off of a carrier. They need a long runway. This plane weighs about 35,000 pounds when it's fully loaded with 4,000 pounds of bombs, a crew of 5, and all the fuel it takes, okay? And it takes basically about over 1,400 feet to go ahead and get off the ground. Well, guess what? They had to learn how to do it in less than 200 feet because in 210 feet, they'd be in the ocean. So what do you think they had to do? Now, we just had a class about what we have to do to get these planes up in the air. What do you think they had to do?
Catapult?
No, catapult hasn't been invented yet, except you do bring up a good point. If you look right here at the this is the USS Hornet. If you look right there where that plane is, there's a small ridge that goes under the thing. Well, you could actually go ahead and launch airplanes through a catapult system right there. Pilots didn't like it because it would knock them out temporarily, and then they had to go ahead and wake back up and then get it. But you could actually launch planes off a catapult. No other carriers had that at the time. Okay, and they never used it because the pilots hated it. Yes?
If you were to drive almost flat, and then right when you get to the end, that's when you pull up so that you have the maximum speed. Is that what you had to do?
You could do it like that. But the problem is you've got to go ahead and lighten these planes. Remember, drag and weight. So they had to lighten the planes. So the first thing they did was they lightened the planes as much as they could. Then they went ahead and took 16 of them. And they put them on there. And remember, you can't put these in the hangar deck. They're not going to fit. Look at how big the elevators are and then how big these planes are. You can't do it. So they went ahead and they lashed them onto the deck and they took off. Even the pilots didn't know what the target was going to be until after they went past the Golden Gate Bridge. And then the pilots were told where they were going to go ahead and bomb. Now, each one of these pilots volunteered for the mission. There was nobody forced to go. The plan was to get about 600, 500 miles off the coast of Japan, go ahead and take off and bomb Japan, and then land in China, because you can't land these things back on an aircraft carrier. Well, unfortunately, about 600 miles off the coast of Japan, they were spotted by a Japanese ship. The U.S. Navy sank that ship, but they didn't know if they had sent the signal to Japan to expect them. So they went ahead and they took off anyway. So that means they had to go ahead and add extra fuel to the planes, which added extra what?
Weight.
So how did they account for this? The plane captains told their guys to pick their favorite gun and take the rest off. So they took off some of their guns and they went down into the mess hall of the ship and they took broom handles, they cut the ends off, they painted them black, and then they stuck them in the holes where the guns would be. So just in case anybody got curious, they might just scare them off. They took off in rough weather. You'll see it in a second. But the plane went up, the carrier went up and they went down, and the pilots had to time it just right, because when the carrier went up on the crest of a wave, they would start to go down the wooden deck. And as the carrier went down and was tossed by the next wave, that would toss them back up into the air. So it gave them just a little bit more oomph. Every one of the planes took off. Not one of them hit the water. And they were on their way to Japan. They bombed the cities of Kobe, Tokyo, Nagoya, and Yokohama. And they didn't bomb civilians, they bombed factories that were making the implements of war. And it didn't really do anything except for the American people. It basically told the American people that yes, they could rise from this. They could rise from the attack on Pearl Harbor, and they were gonna go ahead and come. The other thing is, it had convinced the Japanese people that they were not untouchable. They could be hit, and eventually they were. Unfortunately for the Doolittle Raid, which is called the Doolittle Raid because of Colonel Jimmy Doolittle, who led it, unfortunately, they ended up, because they took off early, a lot of them ended up crashing in occupied China that was occupied by the Japanese. One crew landed in Russia. Two crews were captured, and the rest managed to get back to the United States, okay, eventually. But this is called the Doolittle Raid. This B-25 that you see was made to basically, as an homage to the Doolittle Raiders, to go ahead and see what they had to go through. If you look on this plaque right here, some of the Doolittle Raiders, before they passed on, went ahead and they signed this. So on this plaque, you see the signature of some of the Doolittle Raiders. This is the only plane, by the way, that still flies. You can have a seat on it for $500, but it still flies, and it's the only one that's allowed to carry, if you follow me this way. Mm-hmm. Okay, any questions? This is B-25 Mitchell. We talked about our Predator drone, and we talked about the L-4 Grasshopper. Any other questions over any of the planes that you see here? Okay, make sure.